मीटिंग फेसबुक।
अगर फेसबुक का पेज रहेगा तो पेज पे ट्राई करो, हाँ पेज का ऑप्शन दिखेगा तो।
डन।
यूट्यूब
मैं लॉग आउट कर रहा हूँ और मैं फेसबुक का चेक कर लेता हूँ।
अभी फेसबुक में है लाइव
और यूट्यूब यूट्यूब
स्ट्रीमिंग लाइव ऑन
फेसबुक में कर रहा हूँ अभी वापस।
अच्छा ठीक है चलेगा। और अगर वो उसका नाम चेंज कर दोगे तो अच्छा है जब लाइव करने जाओगे ना।
बट अभी ये लाइव स्टॉप लाइव स्ट्रीम मुझे यूट्यूब के ऑप्शन नहीं आ रहे। अच्छा वो ये है फेसबुक है ना। हाँ ठीक।
मनोज
हाँ
यूट्यूब पे अगर जब चालू करोगे ना तो अगर आपको सब्जेक्ट चेंज करने को मिलेगा ना टाइटल, तो टाइटल चेंज कर देना।
नहीं मनीष अभी मैं फेसबुक पे लाइव किया है बट यूट्यूब का ऑप्शन मुझे नहीं मिल रहा है। एक्चुअली
नहीं मिल रहा है।
आई एम ट्राइंग इट बट वो अभी ऑप्शन नहीं है। लास्ट टाइम देखा था मिला।
इफ यू डोंट गेट मिनट्स फेसबुक पे आया क्या? फेसबुक पे तो दिख रहा है।
यस
दिख रहा है फेसबुक पे मुझे।
हाय
मनोज, फेसबुक पे तो दिख रहा
है। कैन यू टेलीकास्ट द पीपीटी स्क्रीन? बिकॉज़ फेसबुक पे भी अभी सारे के सारे पिक्चर्स ही आ रहे हैं पार्टिसिपेंट्स के। सो इफ वी डू दैट विल गुड नाइसर।
वी आर इन द मीटिंग नाउ। लाइव स्ट्रीमिंग का ऑप्शन एक ही है विवेक, अभी मुझे दूसरा यूट्यूब का ऑप्शन नहीं मिल रहा।
ठीक है, आई थिंक लेट्स स्टार्ट।
ओके
व्हाटएवर।
वो मोर में ऑप्शन अभी नहीं गया, यूट्यूब का चला गया, अभी सिर्फ लास्ट स्टॉप आ रहा है। मैं स्टॉप करके यूट्यूब में जा सकता हूँ।
ठीक है लेट्स स्टार्ट। लेट्स स्टार्ट। यू स्टार्ट द रिकॉर्डिंग बटन देन वी विल अपलोड इट ऑन द यूट्यूब।
रिकॉर्डिंग बटन मुझे करना है।
जरा भेजना।
यस
बट कहाँ पे ऑप्शन?
नीचे।
हाँ रिकॉर्ड ना स्टार्ट करूँ?
यस
ओके। रिकॉर्ड ऑन द क्लाउड।
ऑन द क्लाउड हाँ कर दे।
कनेक्टिंग टू क्लाउड सर्वर।
या
ठीक है।
गुड टू गो।
स्टार्टेड।
YouTube पे नहीं आया अभी तक।
नहीं मुझे YouTube का ऑप्शन अभी नहीं मिल रहा है। स्टॉप करके वापस करना पड़ेगा, करना है तो।
अच्छा अच्छा लीव इट। Facebook पे चालू हुआ ना। चलो लेट्स स्टार्ट। वो मैं अपलोड कर दूंगा बाद में।
जस्ट बिफोर वी स्टार्ट अ कपल ऑफ थिंग्स। फर्स्ट एंड फॉरमोस्ट वी डॉक्टर वेंकटेश्वर मूर्ति हैज बीन रियली काइंड एनफ टू स्क्वीज सम टाइम आउट फॉर अस एंड वी विल टॉक अबाउट द ऑल इंपॉर्टेंट इश्यूज ऑफ कोविड। He'll basically help us separate the facts from the myths. So just a couple of things, I won't waste much time. So he has a presentation which he'll be starting soon. We have divided the presentation into two parts. The first part he'll talk about the symptoms, the test that needs to be done for COVID and a way how you can read those test reports. We all have been reading a lot about CT scans, CT values and all those things. So he will explain what are those parameters. Then we'll take a break of say 5-10 minutes in which you can ask him questions. And again, after that, he'll continue with his presentation. One request that during the presentation, if you have any queries, you can even type it in the chat box. It will, I think, make it easier for Dr. Murthy also because he can look at the questions and he can answer rather than everyone asking the questions at the same time. So if you have any queries, you can type it in the chat box. We all have an option to write in the chat box. So,
that, I think,
Dr. Murthy?
Yeah. Hi, everyone. Good evening.
Good evening.
Firstly, thanks to Manish, Coach Manish and S2B for having me over.
Doctor, 1 minute. Doctor, 1 minute.
Sure.
बाकी सब लोग प्लीज म्यूट कर दो या आशीष या मनोज भी सब लोग को म्यूट कर सकते हैं. सो ओनली डॉक्टर वेंकट, इफ डॉक्टर वेंकट इज टॉकिंग प्लीज अदर्स डोंट टॉक. इफ यू वांट प्लीज टाइप ऑन द चैट, ही विल रीड आउट और वी विल रीड आउट टू द ऑल द क्वेश्चंस. सो इट विल नो डिस्टर्बेंस नहीं रहेगा. प्लीज म्यूट इट.
ओके. So basically, I thought, you know, there's so much going around about COVID since the past more than a year. We have been hearing and talking so much. A lot of you have also had family members, even yourself, some of you have suffered from COVID and come out of it so well. But still, there's so much of fear and so much of unnecessary, rumors and myths going around about this. So I just thought there's something we can chat about and if I can help to clear some doubts and put things in perspective. In also what is happening is in the past 1 year, there's so much of continuous information we are being bombarded with. Things that we thought we were doing right last year, we realized now that we are not doing, we should not be doing those things. The medicines which we were using last year, we're not able to, asked not to use now. So everything is changing over the past 1 year. It is a very, very dynamic and fluid situation, and we are still learning. Even the medical profession is still learning from all the that's been happening around us. So it is obvious that the non-medical person or the layman would not have proper access to the right information. And since Google and WhatsApp is offering us so much of knowledge, we don't even know what to accept and what to believe and what not to believe. So the idea was that we have some little scientific basis of doing things. So I have made a few slides which will help us to get things in perspective. So basically, as I said, we are still learning and we hope that we are going in the right direction. So what has happened is we are now, as we said, we are in the second wave, in the thick of the second wave. And people don't know how much more time we have to endure all this. We really don't know. See, the last flu pandemic of 1918, there were 4 waves. So we don't know how many more waves we'll have to undergo and how many more we'll have to endure. So why is there so much of new things, new knowledge coming? See, either because the virus is itself changing. As we are now hearing of new strains, there is a South African strain, there's a Brazilian strain, there is the double mutation and the Indian strain. So the virus itself is changing. And as with any other disease, as we treat more patients, as the patient base becomes larger and larger, we learn from our mistakes and from our successes. So this last year's experience has taught us a lot of things. But a few things of these are very important and has a bearing for all of us. So the new things we are seeing in the second wave or after 1 year of dealing with this dreadful virus is that this time around, a lot of young children are being affected, which was not the case last year. Secondly, a lot of young adults are becoming serious because we used to only think that people over 55 or 60 or those with other diseases like diabetes or cancer or heart problem or blood pressure, high blood pressure would become serious, but that is not so. A lot of young adults are also becoming serious. Also, the medical world is still grappling with how does the disease even spread? See, like last year when it first started, we were told don't go into lifts, don't touch the lift, don't touch the door, use a matchstick to press the button on the lift and things like that. But now it is kind of more or less clear that it's an airborne disease. Now, what does airborne mean? It means that when I breathe or when I speak, I'm giving germs out along with the air that comes out of my mouth or from my nose. So in what way is this worse? See, these germs come out and they stay in the air around us. So if I'm a patient of COVID, I'm breathing germs out. They come out from my nose and from my mouth. And they stay in the air around me. And depending on the conditions outside, if there's no breeze, if it's a closed environment, then that air around me has germs for a long time. We used to think that it is a droplet infection only. A droplet infection comes out in bigger drops. So these drops come on the floor and settle down. They fall down. They don't stay in the air. So that was better, because if once a droplet fell out, fell down, it was the germs are not around me. But airborne infection means the air around me is full of these germs. So airborne infection makes it worse for us because it is more difficult to control such diseases. Other examples of airborne diseases are measles and chickenpox and TB. So we know how much of a problem TB has been in our country. We know how much of a problem measles and chickenpox have been in the world. So this is one of those diseases which spreads just by being in the air. The other new thing that you have learned is a lot of the treatment. Now in the treatment, things have changed mainly because we have now, we know what we should not be using. A lot of mistakes were made in the past in what drug we were giving and the way of we were treating. So this is now in the treatment, what is new is what a lot of medicines we should not use. So when we come to the any disease, excuse me. Yeah. So the symptoms, basically, we should know one very important thing, that if I have a symptom of COVID today, the spread of the virus has started 3 days before this or 3 or 4 days before this. So that's the reason why it is spreading so fast. So before I realize I have COVID and I get myself tested, I've already spread the disease to people around me, at my home, at my workplace. If I'm traveling or in the bus, because it doesn't give us time to be prepared. It doesn't give us time. The isolation that we do is not so effective. So we have to prevent it from spreading. How do we do this? We will see shortly. As far as symptoms go, as we said, they can be mild, moderate, or severe symptoms. But very important to know, we all know that whatever our symptoms are, the first thing we say is isolate for at home for 14 days. Remember that the second week is the time to be alert, because that after this first 7 or 8 days is when things can go wrong. And that's what usually happens. So between day and age of the illness is the most important part. And this means you have to, even if I'm okay, today is the 5th day and 6th day, I feel I have no fever. I'm so happy that there's no fever since 2 or 3 days. I'm not coughing, but I cannot relax because I have to monitor myself for the next one more week at least. So the second week is a very, very important period, because that is when things can go wrong. So that means I have to be careful. So what do I mean by be careful? I have to monitor my oxygen concentration, oxygen level in the blood for the next week, as well as I was doing it in the first 5, 6 or 7 days. Now we will come to what is called the 6-minute walk test. The 6MWT means 6-minute walk test. So what is a 6-minute walk test? It's a very useful test to find out if things are going to go wrong, if I may be required to be admitted in the hospital. So we all know that we measure our oxygen with the pulse. Can you hear me? Manish, can you hear me?
Yes, yes, we can hear.
Yes, yes.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, great. Yeah, I got some notification that I was muted. All right. So as we said, so we need to measure this oxygen level before and after a 6-minute walk. So this walk is a normal, comfortable walk in our house or wherever we are. And we have to compare the oxygen reading before and after the swab. If very in many people it can fall by 2 or 3%, but if it falls by more than 4%, this means it is not a good sign, and this is where we catch the early, what are called the happy hypoxia patients. Happy hypoxia patients are those who are otherwise all right. They don't have a breathing problem. They don't have fever. They're not coughing too much, but there is things already going wrong in their lungs, and they need to take precautions or report to the doctor so that the treatment can be stepped up to the next level. So the 6-minute walk test is something which everybody can do at home. Just measure your oxygen saturation before and after the walk. If the fall in oxygen level is more than 5, it's not a good sign, and you need to report this to your doctor. Okay, so what are the danger signs? Now, we all know that if I have COVID-19, I may have fever, I may cough, I may feel a bit breathless. So there are a few of these signs in which we have to be more alert. So whereas the normal oxygen levels in all of us are, as everybody probably knows by now, as 98 or 99 or 100%. Sometimes it can be 97. But oxygen level below 94 means that I need help. If the fever is high grade for more than 5 days, now when we mean high grade fever, we mean almost touching 102, more than 101.5, 102 is high grade fever. So if this fever continues for more than 5 days, it's not a good sign and can be taken as a danger sign or as a sign that I need to do something about it. A positive 6-minute walk test, that means when the saturated oxygen level goes down to 5 or more than 5. Increasing breathing problem, I was only coughing mildly, but today I'm having a breathing problem. That is a bad sign. A loss of taste and smell, which everybody knows. Here, the loss of taste is more important. Remember that a loss of smell can be had in any cold, in any allergy, in any kind of viral infection. But a loss of taste is more reliable and more specific sign of COVID-19. Too much of tiredness, sleepiness, body pain, which is out of proportion to my fever or to my general illness. If I feel very tired, which I don't normally feel in whenever I get mild illnesses, that is a bad sign. Now, these are just pointers. This is not does not mean that we have to diagnose ourselves every time. This is just a guideline to help you to catch your doctor earlier, to report to your doctor earlier, and not repent for missing all these. Remember that in the case of comorbidities, like if you have diabetes, if you have high blood pressure, if you are suffering from cancer, if you have, somebody is extremely overweight, very obese, then these signs may not be reliable, and you have to give, in fact, or even a little earlier than this, you may have to report to your doctor if any of these signs are even mildly present. So those are the danger signs. Now that brings us to the tests. As regards the test, we all know that RT-PCR is the gold standard of testing and diagnosing. There's something else called the RAT or the rapid antigen test. The rapid antigen test is not as reliable as the RT-PCR. The rapid antigen test is done sometime because the reports are quicker, almost immediately available. And they are also cheaper. But the RT-PCR is still the gold standard. Now, everybody knows that it can be positive or negative. But when it's positive, there are other things that are there on the report, which seeing which many families or many patients panic. See, now there's something called the CT ratio or CT value on the RT-PCR report. So the CT value, basically, it indicates how much of the virus is there in the sample and how early the virus is showing up in the test. So the more is the virus load, the earlier it will show up on the test, isn't it? So therefore, the CT value is a lower value, means the virus showed up very fast on the test. That means probably your viral load is higher. So a lower level is of higher significance. But remember, this CT value has nothing to do with the CT scan. CT scan and scoring something completely different. So the CT value or CT ratio on the RT-PCR report only means that your viral load is higher. It only means there is probably more virus in your body. That doesn't mean you are a more serious patient of COVID. It only means you have more virus in your body. And I must tell you one thing. Most children who get COVID have a very high viral load because they are probably getting them from some adults or somebody around them, and they have, their bodies are smaller and they probably get a very high load. But that doesn't mean that the child is going to be serious. The next thing is the CT scan. See, the problem is everybody wants to get a CT scan. They don't know why they're doing the CT scan. They just feel they need a CT scan and they need some figures on that. Again, on the CT scan, there are two scores which may be mentioned. But remember, everybody does not need a CT scan unless if you have mild fever, mild cough, cold, and you don't have any breathing problem, you're not very obese, or you don't have diabetes or blood pressure or a heart problem or recovering from a cancer, then you may not need a CT scan at all. A CT scan would normally only be done if you have breathing problem, or if a fever is not going in 5 days or 6 days, and or your oxygen level is coming down. Remember that every CT scan is almost equivalent to taking 70 x-rays. So that means there's a lot of radiation involved in CT scans. So if you can avoid a CT scan, it is much better for your body. Having said that, the ideal timing to do a CT scan is around day 5 or day 6 or day 7, not before that. So the moment your RT-PCR comes, please don't go to a CT scan center and take an appointment yourself. Remember, the CT scan center is not going to refuse you a CT scan. They will do it if you ask, but please don't ask. Please do this under medical guidance. Remember, everyone doesn't need a CT scan, and the best time to do it is probably between day 5 and day 7. Again, on the CT scan, there are two kinds of scores that you may see. One is the CORAD score and the other is the CT severity score. The CORAD score only gives the level of suspicion of COVID. Could this be COVID? So a CORAD score of 1 means this is not likely to be COVID. A CORAD score of 6 means it is most likely, or it definitely is COVID. So if you have a PCR positive or a rapid antigen positive, you do not need a CT scan to diagnose. Last year, we were doing doctors and even people were getting a CT scan done instead of an RT-PCR. This was done to escape the government net, to not to be reported to the MBMC and things like that. But it has no meaning because it is much more hazardous to do a CT scan if you can do a simple RT-PCR. So CORAD score has no meaning whatsoever for the general population.
Sir, can I interrupt you for a moment?
Yeah.
So when, John and I, we both have become COVID positive.
Yeah.
We both did our RT-PCR.
Yeah.
We did it 2 times within a week's time, but every time it was negative. But John was coughing nonstop. Only HRCT showed that he has COVID positive, and for me also.
Yeah.
How come?
Again, if your doctor had to suspect COVID and he was not getting a diagnosis on the RT-PCR, then he was right in doing the CT scan.
Okay.
Your question may be then why did the RT-PCR come negative?
Yes.
So you have to understand that no single test it can be 100% accurate. Every test has a small percentage of negative and positive, which may mislead the doctor. But if the doctor decides that this is COVID and it has to be done, he has to prove in some way, then he may go beyond the RT-PCR and do a CT scan. That's a different situation. But we're talking about people who have RT-PCR positive, who just want to get a CT scan because they think it's the right thing to do. So what I'm saying is you don't have to do a CT scan. This is every patient of COVID does not have to do a CT scan. That's what I'm trying to say.
I got your point, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. So the other score that you may see on the CT scan is the severity score. This only tells us what is the severity of lung involvement. It can be mild or moderate or severe. So if that number is less than 8, it is called mild. If it is called 9 to 15, it is moderate. If it is more than 15, it is severe. Again, this is just a scoring to guide us. This does not mean this mild, does not mean my disease is mild. Moderate does not mean my disease is moderate. A severe score does not mean I'm serious. So what I'm trying to tell you is don't read all these things and panic, because sometimes this can mislead you. Okay, this only means that on the X-ray picture, it is so much. But we have to see what is the patient's condition. Ultimately, we have to treat the patient and not the reports. That brings us to a number of blood tests which are done. Now, again, a lot of patients get this done themselves, or they get it done at the doctor's advice. I have divided this into three. There are many other blood tests which can be done, but the CRP, ferritin, LDH are usually done to find out is the disease becoming more or less. Now, a CRP is normally up to less than 6 or up to 6. A lot of patients see a CRP of 9 or 12 or 15 and they panic. You should not panic, because CRP's levels go to 150 and 200 and things like that. So a level of 9 or 10 or 12 is really nothing. It only means that there is the disease process going on in your body and we have to monitor it. So CRP, ferritin, LDH, these are done usually in admitted patients or even in sometimes patients who are at home. We need a baseline level. So we do one level and then we may repeat it every 3 or 4 days during the illness, depending on the other symptoms. If the fever and cough and things are progressing, then your doctor will get this done every 2 or 3 or 4 days to see if the disease also is progressing. So these three are similar in the information they give us. D-dimer is concerned with clotting. So as we all know, as the disease progresses, if it becomes serious, if I become serious with COVID, then probably there's abnormal clotting happening in my lung. So D-dimer is the test that is done to see if clotting is happening. So D-dimer, if it is very high, it probably means the patient is really getting very sick or getting serious. Now, we are all aware of most of us must have heard of the terms like cytokine storm. A cytokine storm is what happens when most of the patients become dramatically serious. So what is cytokine storm? We all know that the immune system that each of us have, our immune system helps to fight diseases. And it attacks the germs which attack our body. And it neutralizes or kills those germs and protects us from disease. But during cytokine storm, what happens, because of the way the virus plays with the immune system is fooled into attacking the body's own tissues. So that's why those who have a cytokine storm have a kidney problem, a lung problem, a brain problem, or a heart problem. It affects all the body tissues, and therefore these patients often become very serious and can even die. So IL-6 is, or interleukin-6 is the test that is done to find out if this patient is likely to go into a cytokine storm. So these are some of the blood tests that are done and what it means to us. Having said all this, remember at all times, we have to treat the patient according to the condition and not the reports. So we cannot, I get a lot of patients who will send me a D-dimer report, or will send me a CT scan report, or send me an X-ray report and say, doctor, this is my father's report. Is he serious or not? We cannot say the seriousness of a patient by seeing the reports. Seriousness of the patient depends on what are the problems he or she is having, what is the degree of lung damage, what is the level of oxygen in the body, what was it yesterday, what is it today, is he improving or is he worsening? So remember that treatment is based on condition of the patient and not on the reports. So that is the first half of what I wanted to talk to you. Is there any questions? I can take them.
Doctor, there are a few queries in the...
If you have any doubts about something you follow or something which...
There are a few queries in the chat box, if you can just have a look.
Sorry?
There are a few queries in the chat box, if you can have a look.
Sure, I'll do that. Yeah. Yeah, they're mostly, what should I say, to do with preventive measures. I'm coming to that. I'm coming to all these things. Okay.
Ashish, can we read one question by one so that others also will listen?
Okay.
Yeah, we can.
I'm a little stuck here. One second. Okay, there is somebody which said there's news in the media that pulse oximetry shows only low SpO2 when there is 40% damage to lung. How true is that? One more query is, does more than 4% foreign level of after 6 minute test hint only at COVID or could be sign of any other condition too? The first thing is 40% lung damage, I don't think, because even a simple asthmatic who has a lower SpO2, or if you are having a pneumonia of any other type, you can have a low SpO2 and it doesn't mean that there's a 40% lung damage. No. It's not true. The other query says, see, the 6 minute walk test has been devised only for COVID. I really wouldn't know if it can be worked for anything else, but logically it should. Logically it should work for other diseases too. But this thing has been, I think, devised and made popular only now in times of COVID. I don't think it is used for anything else. This is a very important question. Someone said the danger signs, are all danger signs required in an individual patient? No, the answer is no. You can have any one of these danger signs and then you have to. Now, when I say danger, I don't mean the patient is going to die in the next 4 hours. What I mean is this is going to the next level. So you have to take precautions, maybe give oxygen. If you're at home, think of going to a hospital or report to your doctor and let him or her take a decision what needs to be done. So all danger signs need not be there at all times. Someone wants to know what is the best kind of mask to use. See, N95 is the best kind of mask that is available, but it is expensive and it can be in short supply. And everyone doesn't need, see the point is a common person, the layman or a common man who's not dealing with patients of COVID in the ICU or something, they don't need to wear an N95 mask. But what happens is the current recommendation is to have a double mask. Everyone should wear a double mask, and the recommendation also is to wear a mask even within the home, because as we said, airborne infection can be very difficult to beat. So you should wear a mask even at home, and you wear a double mask. I'll be showing you how the double mask is worn. So what they say is, the surgical mask that we wear, generally all of us wear, doctors in our clinics. So that's the surgical mask. And that with the cloth mask on top is what is recommended for everybody. Please explain if it's possible to spread virus through air. Yes, that's what I was saying. The virus is now proven. It is thought that it's an airborne virus. That means the virus is coming out now. If I am a COVID patient, as I'm speaking, as I'm breathing, the virus is coming out. And they are in such fine particles that they don't even fall down, or they don't settle on the table and they dry up and the virus dies. They remain in the air for long periods. That is why they say don't come close. That's why social distancing, and that is why masking at all times. Masking is what will prevent a spread of a disease like this. Somebody wants to know, what if you have recovered from COVID now, can you get it again? Yes, you can get it again, but the chances are very low. However, you can get it again. Therefore, even if you have recovered from COVID, you need to wear a mask, sanitize, and have social distancing. Okay, now there's a whole lot of things people want to know about, things like kada and steaming and all that. None of these things really help. It was thought that steaming helps, but doesn't help. A lot of children have been burnt because of steaming. We see burns of the cheeks and burns of the chest wall in children. So steaming doesn't help. Gargling can help routinely as a general health measure, but is not specific. Camphor is not proven for prevention of COVID. So none of these things are really foolproof. There's a nice question. Should one wear a mask while walking early mornings or when people are not around? Difficult to answer. If no one is around, it's always safer to wear a mask. And I know a lot of runners do not run with masks, but please be informed that it is very unsafe. You should run with masks. You run with whatever speed you can run, how much of a distance you can run. But wait for a few months more and then you can run like you used to run before. So running without masks is a big no. A lot of you are complaining that you sweat and you cannot breathe. Then don't run, just walk. I think life is more important than running, isn't it? A lot of questions on masks. I think I've answered those.
Sir, this is Ashish.
Yep.
Yeah, I think we can continue the presentation, and at the end we'll have a face-to-face Q&A, or else you'll just be tied up.
Yeah,
tied up scrolling up and down.
Kind of, yeah, because a lot of these questions are going to be addressed in the second half.
Right.
So if it does, if you still feel the need, I will be very glad to answer those questions.
Yeah, they can ask face-to-face basis rather than going. You will have to go through all the chats then.
Sure. Yeah. Thank you, Ashish.
Thank you.
So to go on, to continue. So when we have to discuss treatment, we need to know that there is a mild disease, a moderate disease, and a severe disease. Everyone should remember that COVID, 80% of COVID patients are mild. What we are still seeing every day in my clinic, I see a lot of children and adults, everybody seems to have mild COVID. So mild COVID requires nothing more than paracetamol for the fever, some medicine for cold, some nose drops, something for a cough, and some multivitamins maybe, and nothing else. So mild disease is just mild fever, mild body pain, maybe mild cough, cold, with normal oxygen, no breathing difficulty. And of course, if I have any of the comorbidities, I have to be alert that I may become worse very, sooner than somebody else who doesn't have the comorbidities. Moderate disease is when there is a mild amount of breathlessness, or oxygen saturation is between, say, 90 and 93, 94, a mild breathing difficulty. The moderate ones are the ones which are, I think, causing more panic among patients and among the healthcare workers, because nobody wants their patient to deteriorate. Nobody wants their family member to become from moderate to severe. But moderate basically needs aggressive monitoring. Your doctor may put you on some specific COVID treatment, and you have to then do your 6-minute walk test, monitor yourself more aggressively, maybe look for a hospital bed. But remember, a lot of harm is being done by wasting hospital beds and oxygen when you really don't need it. Please remember that every unindicated hospital admission is a waste of a bed, and probably somebody else is dying of not getting a bed and oxygen. So don't rush your loved ones to hospital for admission unless they really need it. Talk to your doctor. remember, if you panic, even we doctors may panic for you, because we are also human. So the idea of, that was one idea of having this kind of information exchange is, I always feel that when a patient is empowered with knowledge, a patient's family has knowledge, they can cope with the disease and the complications better. So the idea of having so much knowledge is not to panic. The idea is to reduce panic and to reduce unnecessary burden on this, on our hospitals. And as we can see, it is getting hopelessly overburdened and on the point of collapse. So be aware that not every patient needs an ICU and not every patient is going to become serious or die. The third category is severe disease, those who have very low oxygen saturation, less than 90, who are very breathless, who may need a ventilator very soon or an ICU very soon. Definitely the severe category has to be in the hospital and the doctors, and then kind of it is not up to you what treatment has to be done. The doctor in the hospital will decide what treatment has to be done. Now, I'm not going into the details of what treatment is to be given. Most patients and most of the laymen are now aware of what is being given, and we are kind of, people order treatment. They say, mujhe steroid chalu karo, mujhe remdesivir chahiye, mujhe oxygen chahiye. But remember, as I said, leave it to your doctor and the medical fraternity. But certainly the last few months or years have told us what mistakes we had made, we as a medical, community overall. So antibiotics are now really thought to be unnecessary in this, because it's viral infection, antibiotics will have no role to play. So azithromycin and doxycycline and Augmentin, these things are out. They're really not in favor now to be used. Ivermectin is completely out. You don't need to, there's no role for ivermectin. I forgot to mention HCQ. HCQ also is completely out of the list. It is not shown to be effective at all. So people asked me then, why were these drugs used? The point is, when COVID started, nobody knew what was happening. Nobody knew how to save a patient. Nobody knew what would work. And depending on some prior experience with certain illnesses or what we thought COVID was, certain drugs were tried. And in any trial which gave even a slight kind of positive feedback, it became a recommendation, because there was no time to think. Doctors had no time to think and form bigger studies. So any shred of hope that any drug gave was used. But now that we've had breathing time over the past few months, many of these drugs are now thrown out from the list, and we know that they're not useful. The third drug I mentioned here, Fabiflu or Fabiprevir, there are two opinions. A lot of doctors, medical people feel you should not use it. It's also used in some patients. I think I leave it to the individual doctor. They would decide what to do. But remember, drugs like remdesivir, steroids like Dexona, methylprednisolone, prednisone, and of course the famous tocilizumab, these are all to be used only under medical supervision. These are the drugs which form the mainstay of moderate and severe cases. What are not added to the list, which are to be used when the doctor suspects that blood clotting is going to be is happening in the body. An important part of the treatment is a simple thing like proning. Proning means lying on your tummy, like in the lower part of the picture. So this is a Government of India health poster, which shows very rightly that how important it is for COVID patients to lie ulta on their stomach. This is called proning. There are various reasons why lying on your tummy can improve your oxygenation. That's because the pressure of various other organs on your lungs is reduced, and the lungs have more space to breathe and take in oxygen. So proning is a very, very important thing. Proning means you lie on your tummy with your face down, your back up, and there's a pillow below your chest and shoulders. It helps a lot to improve oxygen levels. It should be used even during home isolation when you don't have a major oxygen problem. It's also very useful when a patient is getting more sick and waiting for an ICU, waiting for an ambulance, waiting for oxygen, even in such situations. This is shown to be a very important and small measure which you can do at home to improve the condition of many patients of COVID. So this is the position in which you're supposed to lie. You lie on your tummy with a pillow below your chest and shoulders, and you wait patiently and you will improve. The big word now is plasma. Everybody is running after plasma. Lot of every group you will find people saying, "Mujhe plasma chahiye. Where will I get plasma from?" Again, plasma is not as a greater thing as we thought last year. Again, last year a lot of panic led to plasma being used, but it is now surely it is definite that it is used only in the is used for only the first few days of the disease becoming serious. Also remember, plasma from vaccinated individuals is not recommended at the moment, only from those that suffer from COVID. So plasma, don't waste your time and money looking for plasma. It is not very useful at all. Very important question, but unfortunately very less to tell you about this. Everybody wants to know kya khana chahiye, COVID mein kya nahi khana chahiye. Like in every other illness, or as we always say, life in general, eat a lot of healthy food, have a lot of water, have a lot of fruits. But nothing special to say. Unfortunately, kuch bhi khao, eat good family cooked food, eat a lot of fruits, have a lot of water, it will help. So there is something called the importance of mental health. It is very important to be positive. The family and the patient have all to be positive. Anxiety, negative thoughts, stress can worsen the outcome, because it is now shown that cytokine storm gets worse when you're stressed and when you're full of negativity and worry and stress. The body handles cytokine storm better when there are positive thoughts. So how do you be positive? I have COVID. I have moderate level of COVID. I'm staying in a quarantine center away from my family. I know it's difficult, but the only way to be positive is to maybe engage in meditation, prayer, hear soothing music, do some light exercise for your limbs, for your small muscles or something like that. For those who are not very sick, you can help others. You can talk to others, talk to them, give them counseling. You know, the power of soothing words to a friend, it can never be underestimated. So meditation, prayer, all this really helps. So please don't rely on Google and WhatsApp. About three messages received in such things, traffic, the they have to do ridiculously bad. Magic is a magic wand which can just remove COVID from your body. So basically, it's also a time, COVID is also a time to introspect, thank God and the Almighty for things you have. Enjoy what you have, enjoy your family, enjoy the friendships that you have. And also, as we said, it's also said helping others gives you a lot of positivity. Trying to talk to somebody else, give some advice, try to remove their doubts, make them feel better. That also makes you feel better from inside. And now it is also scientifically proven, as I said, these things are effective in combating the cytokine storm. So that kind of brings us to the end of the treatment. Something which is closer to me, in my heart, kids. Even though we are seeing a lot of children suffering from COVID now, in fact, children are the people who bring COVID into the house, because the restrictions were lifted after almost a year, more than a year. Children were going down to play, meeting everybody. And I think they are a very big instrument in bringing the virus back home. Fortunately for us, kids suffer mild symptoms usually. They don't have a very small percentage of children become serious like the adult counterparts. they don't require normally any special anti-COVID treatment. As the first time, the yellow is very important. Any patient, any family where there's a child with COVID, we are worried about the grandparents because it instantly puts the grandparents at risk. Also, not only the grandparents whom the child is staying with, but even the other set of grandparents. Because the moment a father or a mother or an uncle or aunt gets COVID, the child is immediately shifted to the other grandparents' house, from Dadi's house to Nani's house. And as I told you in the beginning, the moment anybody is diagnosed or feels ill with COVID, 3 or 4 days before that, he or she has already spread the germs to others. So your child has not only infected the grandparents in this house, but you send them away to your in-laws' house and they infect the grandparents there too. So remember that if any adult gets COVID, it is very likely that the children of the house will also get COVID. But don't worry, don't panic, don't send the children away. Keep them with you because you don't want the child to infect others. So that's said and done. So in children below 1 year, and especially those below 4 weeks, newborns means up to 28 days or 4 weeks, they are at a little higher risk of getting serious COVID. Otherwise, children are not worrisome. That brings us to prevention and COVID appropriate behavior. So let's not be COVID idiots. Let's be co-wise. So let's mask up, do social distancing, wash hands frequently, sanitize frequently. As I said, it is now thought to be a purely airborne disease, which makes it worse for us because airborne diseases are more difficult to control. And we have to be very, very meticulous with our masks. So double masking is now recommended. A lot of international bodies, including the CDC of USA, our own ICMR and other health bodies are all asking for recommending double masking. How do you double mask? Let me tell you, these cloth masks are totally useless. All the printed, lovely, beautiful matching cloth masks people wear are all useless. Let's not you wear those. So as you can see, there's a mask inside there and there's a mask outside too. That is the surgical mask which you have to wear. So surgical mask has to be worn with a knot there so it remains tight around your face. And then on top of that, you wear another mask, which can be a cloth mask. So when there is double masking, it is recommended you wear a surgical mask inside and a cloth mask over that. The vaccine, everybody knows about the vaccine. I'm not going to talk much about this. Is that time up? I mean, how much time do I have?
We have some time.
Okay. So basically the vaccine, everybody who's offered the vaccine and who fits into the criteria, please take the vaccine. Don't think too much. Adverse effects are quite rare and at the most fever and pain. Even your children have been tolerating for every vaccine shot they take almost. So there's no reason why we should not be able to tolerate it. People in my family, 86 and 88, have taken the vaccine. So there is no reason for children, people above 75, 80 to be scared. Don't go for any one brand of vaccine over the other. They're almost all the same. See, all this percentage efficacy, which you see, the differences in all the vaccine is not for, you can measure the efficiency or the protective value of a vaccine for different stages of the disease. Like you can say, is Covishield protecting against mild disease or moderate disease or severe disease in the ICU? Is it protecting, preventing deaths? So when you see all the grades of COVID, that is where the difference in all the vaccine comes. But if you compare the vaccine data of all the brands, more or less all the brands available, if you see them only for mild and moderate disease, the protection is almost the same in all. So don't please keep asking the question, Konsa vaccine lo, Covishield lo, Covaxin lo, which is better? They're all almost the same. As I said, they're like Coke and Pepsi, almost similar. So most people would know the difference between a Coke and a Pepsi. So it's like that, take whatever's available. Don't change the brand. If someone has told you, take Covishield today, and then they say tomorrow, no, Covishield, Covaxin is better. Do, please don't change the brand. There is no data to show that anyone, you can mix brands of vaccine. We don't know. Try not to mix vaccines. What about the gap between two vaccines? There was a fad which said, take it after 6 weeks or 8 weeks. But a lot of people waiting for the 6 weeks to get over got COVID after the first vaccine. So please don't delay your vaccine shots. Take it after the original prescribed 28 or 30 days. Because you don't know what the extra waiting period is going to do to you. We don't know when the virus is going to attack whom. So that's about the vaccine. When will the vaccine be available for children? We don't know. Maybe by next year, we're not sure. Are all the vaccines similar? No. Covaxin, Covaxshield are kind of similar. The Pfizer one all and the others are mRNA vaccines, a totally different technology. What about Sputnik? Sputnik, both the vaccines are different medications. In all other vaccines, when we say you have to take two or three every month, the vaccine is the same, the medicine is the same. But in the Sputnik, which is the Russian vaccine, which is going to be made available in India by Apollo, it is the two, one and two are different medicines. So that is way, in the one way, which is Sputnik is different from the others. But no major side effects. It can be given to pregnant women. It has been started in other countries. In our country, the recommendation from the body of gynecologists, the official body, the recommendation has just come that you can take it even if you're pregnant. Of course, again, we leave it to the individual vaccinator, the individual family, their comfort level to take it in for a pregnant woman, but there is no contraindication to take the vaccine in pregnancy. How about if a lady is breastfeeding a child, can she take the vaccine? Yes, she can take the vaccine. There is no data to suggest that she cannot take a vaccine if she's feeding her child. So that more or less brings us, okay, another question that I'm often asked is, do I do the antibody levels before? Now again, there are two kinds of antibody levels. One is the IgG antibody, which gives you the level of antibodies, but this is pertaining to the natural infection. If I have got COVID 2 months ago, then I will have a higher level of IgG antibodies. The other level of antibody which can be measured is called the spike protein, spike antibody. The antibody that comes with vaccination is the spike antibody. That's the one which gives you the effectivity of the vaccine. But do you need to do an antibody level after the first, after the second? Not at all. Why? Why do you want to get poked? Why do you want to spend more money? It has no meaning because the antibody is not the only thing that will prevent you from the disease. There are other mechanisms in the body which can use, which the body used to will use to protect you against the disease. So antibody is not the only thing. So I think that's all what I have wanted to share with you. Of course, you're open to questions if you have the time.
I think we have around 10-12 minutes, so maybe we can take a few questions. Okay. But before we start, there are a few questions in the chat box, which I'll just read out, and maybe you can just take it one by one or in a bag.
That'll be helpful.
So there are a couple of generic queries, like what are the general precautions for severe patients post recovery? Then there is a query, after how many days can one take the first vaccine? As in, if someone has tested positive and after that quarantine period, he has tested negative.
Yeah, can you just answer that immediately?
Yeah.
8 weeks after your, the thing is when you have to take the vaccine.
8 weeks, okay.
Yeah.
Then there's another query that if there's a COVID patient in the house and post the quarantine and everything, is there any need to sanitize the house? Then
See, sanitizing is kind of out because, as I said, this we used to do sanitization of surfaces and all that when we thought that COVID virus spreads from surfaces. But now the surface thing is out. That theory is no longer valid because it is in the air. It's not on the surface. So that's why we used to, that going into a lift and using a toothpick or a matchstick to press your floor and all that is given up. Even in our clinics, we don't sit and sanitize the mattress where we see the patient after every patient. We don't do all those things because the way of spread is now given up. It is now proven that it's exclusively airborne. Okay. So you don't need to sanitize the whole house. I mean, people are doing it, but you don't need to do that. Maybe you need to only sanitize the room where the patient was, if the patient has coughed on a bed or things like that. But like we still have patients in our building, they sanitize the moment somebody is diagnosed, somebody comes and sanitizes the whole building. All that is not required. It's a waste of effort and money.
Another query was, what is the probability of getting COVID after the vaccination?
See, there is no, I don't think there's any calculated probability I can tell you. But the point is, you may get COVID. See, it's like any other disease, like we are immunizing for chickenpox. There are many children who get chickenpox even after the vaccine dose is completed. But they don't get severe illnesses. They don't get complications. The same thing of TB. Every child receives a BCG vaccine in the shoulder, left shoulder, as soon as the child is born. That doesn't mean that that child will never get TB in his life. Vaccines, some of them prevent the disease itself, but many vaccines are given to prevent serious disease. So we are already seeing it now. A lot of senior citizens have received the two doses of vaccine and they have got COVID after that, but they are not in an ICU. Many of them are not dying as they probably would have last year if they got the disease. So you can get COVID again, COVID after vaccination, but it will not be a severe disease. It will be a milder disease. And the chances of going into an ICU, being admitted, chances of dying are very, very less compared to non-vaccinated individuals.
Okay, one query specific regards to senior citizens. So there's a query said that there's a senior citizen who has recovered now, but he was in the ICU earlier. So is there any specific precautions or monitoring that needs to be done? Are there any risk related to, say, heart or sugar, anything?
See, the biggest risk at such situations for those people who have been in an ICU, who have been a bit serious with COVID, is the damage to the lungs. A lot of them will get what is called a post-COVID lung disorder, where the lung may not function as well as it used to before. So we have heard stories of marathoners who after COVID are not able to even run 2 kilometers because their lung doesn't function like it used to. Basically, it takes time. It is reversible, but whether it will go back to the completely pre-COVID situation, we don't know. That depends on specific patient's medical history. If he was an asthmatic, if he was a smoker, if he had some other lung ailment, then he will not be his normal self. His lung may not, like if he was at level 3 before COVID and he became a level 9 because of COVID, he may not come back to 3. His level may be at 6 or 7. Like a lot of them, the saturations, even after discharge, the oxygen level is not going beyond 94 or 95 for 2 or 3 weeks. They are at home, they're otherwise okay, they're eating well, they're off all major medication, but it's taking time. So the lung is the one that's going to be maximally affected after you go home. Children, there are some other things that we see. They are called PIMS and MISC and such things. So basically, a lot of tissues are parts of the body is affected 2 or 3 or 4 weeks after they recover from COVID. So in this situation, the children may have had very mild COVID, just mild fever and cough and something like that. But after 3 or 4 weeks, their body is affected by this, where their lungs are affected, the heart may be affected, they get rashes, they have a skin peeling and all these things. So that is also seen in children. So that is a later consequence. In adults, it is really the lung, and in children, they are seeing we are seeing this thing called PIMS.
They say, what are the general precautions one can take if someone has recently recovered from a severe case of COVID?
Okay. So one thing is your isolation. Most of the experts believe that you have to be isolated for 3 weeks and not 2 weeks. The point is your COVID virus, your coronavirus stops replicating in your body after 9 days. That means you are probably not making virus in your body after 9 days. So you will not infect others after 10 or 12 days. So to be sure, they said 14 days. So what experts have said is, if you are in home isolation, after 14 days, you can come out of your bedroom or your room and meet others in your family. But don't go out of the house for another 1 week. So 20 or 21 days, that is 3 weeks, is what they're recommending. You should be away from people. That is one thing. Otherwise, there's nothing specific. Now, depending on how much of your lung was affected, you may be on anticoagulants, blood thinners. You may be on the vitamins. You may be on high-dose vitamin C. Those medicines have to continue. Otherwise, you just have to take normal co-wise COVID precaution, have COVID appropriate behavior, and do the usual masking and avoiding crowds and things. Nothing specific otherwise. If you have a lung problem, you have to take precautions in your activity, and that will be told to you by your lung doctor or by a COVID physician.
Any specific multivitamin or anything that in immunity boosting supplements?
Excuse me. See, again, vitamins, nothing specific. Kind of vitamin C is a panacea for is good for general health and immunity. And multivitamin sab log dete hain. Everybody's on Zincovit or something. So they wo lete raho. We don't know if it really helps. It won't do any harm for sure. But please don't do this camphor and this kadhas and all that. Again, kadhas are okay, but camphor inhalation. As I said, in children, please don't do steam inhalation. It burns children's tender skin. So that which is potentially harmful, please avoid.
But these multivitamins or zinc supplements, they can anyway, in general, can people continue for, say, not just for because we are going through COVID, but in general, throughout your life, in between, can they?
They can, but they need not. They should not. I mean, why would I need to take vitamins if I'm having a normal diet? Need not. But vitamin D, they say, has a role to play. So vitamin D is supposed to improve immunity. And according to some experts, also helps in COVID. So vitamin D is one vitamin which is worth giving everybody. So that you can take for 6 months or a year or whatever. But remember, vitamin D is one vitamin which cannot be taken in high doses. It has side effects. It accumulates in the body. So it has to be taken in the right doses and under your doctor's supervision.
Yeah.
Doctor, I have one query. Hello, doctor.
Yes.
Hello. Hi. This is Akshita. Hi. I just want to know one question. I have one question. If I don't have any symptoms and I work at airport, so do I need to do RT-PCR? If yes, then after how many weeks or after how many days? Because I never know, like if a passenger is positive or my staff is positive. So if I don't have any symptoms, do I need to do RT-PCR?
See, the point is RT-PCR only tells you don't have, if your RT-PCR is negative, it only shows you don't have COVID on that day. There's no guarantee you may get RT-PCR when you come back from that same lab with the report the next day. Nobody can predict or can quantify these things. As a general working rule, government of Maharashtra issued some notice some time back, saying for all these, courier boys and I think people who work for Zomato and such places, that you need to produce an RT-PCR every 15 days. But this is something very random. There is no, like, see, as I say, it's like dusting a table. I dust a table now, but the windows open, the dust is going to settle over the next 4 hours. Not even, it won't even happen after 1 day. So this virus is just all around us. So we don't know when it's going to come. So RT-PCR today only means I'm negative today. It doesn't mean I won't be negative, positive tomorrow. So there is no way to kind of have any, you know, very comfortable way to say that if you've done RT-PCR today, repeat only after 1 month or something like that. People like you and people like us who are meeting people every day are always at risk of getting the disease. So we have to take precautions to protect ourselves.
Dr. Murthy, good evening. I am Priya Gururani here. Dr. Murthy, hi. I just wanted to tell you this query was posted by me, which Ashish raised, like my mother, who was in a very critical condition last October and could manage and come out of this deadly infection. Now it's almost 5-6 months, Dr. Murthy, but I can still see she's not back to the normal, though I got her cardiac monitoring and everything done. So is there any risk, or still it's going to take time? As you said, the lungs are, you know, that's the point probably. Otherwise, that routine is on, but I am still not finding that old energy or that in her.
Yes, unfortunately, we can never say how long it will take for your mother to bounce back to fully normal. You have to kind of, accept the fact that a lung of a 60-year-old or an 80-year-old is not the same as a lung of a, a 25 or a 30-year-old. As many of you are runners, you know that as age advances, it takes longer for recovery from any small injury too. Just like that, you know.
She's vaccinated, but still I can, you know, she still has that risk of getting infected again, or she needs to be taken extreme.
She still has the risk of getting infected again. Oh, okay. But only we hope and pray that the vaccine does not give her a... Because the vaccine,
she fights back,
the severe infection like she got last time.
Okay, and one more thing, doctor. For the kids, you had last time prescribed the Zincovit, and there was another tablet which you asked us to give it for a month or so. So, likewise, do you suggest to repeat that 1 month course again?
Yes, this was last year when we were still kind of desperately giving medicines.
Right.
We just kind of stopped doing that now because we really don't know how long to give it for. Vitamin C, you can give it. Yeah,
because the child is fine, but in case if you want for
you
again.
You may give. You don't have to give. You may give. No harm. Vitamin C is good. Okay. You're helping the pharma companies also.
Sure.
So.
Doctor, I have one question. Ashish, I have one question.
Sure, Anish, yes.
Yeah. So, doctor, since the vaccination drive is going on, so most of the young generation who are in the sports field, in the athletics or the amateur runners or cyclists who are there, so how many days prior they should stop the training so that inflammation, because whatever activity we do, inflammation aata hai. So, inflammation nahi hoye aur vaccine pe kuch effect nahi hoye aisa, kitne din pehle activity rok dena chahiye ya? हम लोग कुछ दिन भी एक्टिविटी करके वैक्सीनेशन लेने जा सकते हैं.
Of course, एक्टिविटी करके जा सकते हैं. There is no, I don't know any recommendation that you should stop physical activity for a vaccine. No, nothing like
no,
that.
No, so I had seen some article 2 days prior कम कर देना चाहिए, और जिस दिन लेने जाना है उस दिन बंद कर देना चाहिए, so that कि जो बॉडी में इन्फ्लेमेशन रहेगा वो थोड़ा कम हो जाएगा, बिकॉज अगर कोई हाई इंटेंसिटी
एक्सरसाइज. See, probably they are trying to say that, you know, अगर आपको कुछ पेन वेन होने वाला है तो यू वोंट नो कि वैक्सीन से पेन है कि आपके एक्टिविटी से पेन है. बट आई डोंट थिंक दैट यू नीड टू स्टॉप एनी एक्टिविटी. आई एम नॉट अवेयर ऑफ एनीथिंग लाइक दिस. आई डोंट नो, फ्रैंकली आई डोंट नो. I don't think
inflammation ka kuch inflammation ka koi role nahi hai with the vaccination.
Nothing. At the most, you may have more pain. अभी ऑलरेडी आई स्प्रेन माय एंकल व्हाइल रनिंग, प्लस मेरा वैक्सीन यहां दुख रहा है, सो आई हैव डबल द पेन, बट डजंट मीन एनीथिंग एल्स.
और मे बी लॉन्ग रन किया तो सोरनेस आ ही रहा है, और वो इंजेक्शन का भी सोरनेस.
यू वोंट नो वेदर योर वैक्सीन की वजह से है, एंड एवरीवन लाइक्स टू ब्लेम द वैक्सीन फॉर ऑल दिस, सो दे कांट ब्लेम द वैक्सीन बिकॉज़ दे फॉरगॉट दे आल्सो रन.
करेक्ट.
इट हैज नो साइंटिफिक बेसिस. आई डोंट थिंक सो.
या थैंक यू
डॉक्टर.
आई हैव अ क्वेश्चन. हेलो, देयर आर सम क्वेश्चंस आई हैव.
Mamta.
Hello.
Yes, yeah, so I just wanted to hello.
Yes, your voice hello? Is echoing. I can't understand. Your voice is echoing, madam.
Okay, Murthy sir, are you able to hear me?
Yes, now I can hear you. Yes.
Yeah. Okay, so sir has just suggested that vitamin D is good for to be given to kids and the. So can sir suggest any medicine for kids and for elders so that we can take that medicine?
See, so vitamin D. If you want to give on a daily basis, you have to give any vitamin D which has about 800 units. Vitamin okay. D is available as 400 units, 800 units, 1000 units, 2000 units. These are the ones that you can take on a daily basis. So for the child, you can give 800 units per day. That is available in liquid. You can give 1 ml per day. You can give it for up to a year also. Most children, we are giving vitamin D long term, even before we were hit by COVID and coronavirus. So you can give any of the brand which says 800 international units. For adults, I guess you can give 2000 units every day. But or 1000 if you get is a more smaller dose. See, vitamin D is a vitamin, as I said, which accumulates in the body and it can cause problems if you have a very high dose also, unlike other vitamins. So you can take 1000 or 2000 units per day. This can be taken for 3 to 6 months. For growing children, we are giving it for 1 or 2 years, 800 units per day.
Hi, good evening, doctor. This is Anand here.
Yeah,
I just wanted to ask you a question. Is RT-PCR test 100% accurate? Because there was an instance where one of my colleague had all the symptoms of COVID, but after testing thrice, he was negative. But the person who was in close contact with him reported positive.
See, as in any other test, no test is 100% kind of reliable. As a basic, basic scientific fact, every test will have a small percentage of what we call false negatives or false positives. This is the inherent drawback of any medical test. Besides that, it can also be negative if it is not done properly. Now, when you take the swab, it has to be put in and turned inside your nose. It has to be put inside your mouth and nicely rubbed up on the back of your mouth. If these things are not done properly, you will not get what is called a positive test or a positive yield. So there can be various reasons for a negative test.
Okay.
Such times when your COVID scoring on the CT scan, CORAD scoring can help. As I was telling somebody else, the symptoms of corona or COVID are there, but the RT-PCR is negative. There is a worsening of symptoms, and that is when the CT scan can be done. And on that, the CORAD score, then that number has some meaning. A CORAD score of 4, 5, or 6 means there's very high chance of this being COVID in spite of the negative RT-PCR.
Okay. Thanks, doctor.
Okay. Sorry, but friends, we have run out of time, so we won't be able to take more questions. But before we end, on behalf of Snails to Bolt, I would really like to thank Dr. Murthy because he took time. I mean, these are tough times for a doctor as well. And I'm sure you would be running on a tight schedule. So I really thank you for taking time out and addressing our doubts. And I'm sure everyone would have benefited because there's a lot of talk about this whole disease in the social media. So it was, this session couldn't have come at a better time.
Thank you. Thank you for having me and allow me to express my thoughts and glad to be of help. You can always message me through S2B or through directly those who have access to me. Not a problem. Thank you, S2B. Sure.
Thank you so much, doctor. Thank you so much, doctor. Thank you, Ashish, thank you, everyone.
For moderating this so well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Murthy. Thank you, the host team. You take care of yourself.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye-bye. Welcome. It's been a pleasure.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Thank you, doctor.
Thank you, doctor.
Be safe.
Thank you
Bye-bye.
So much.
Thank you.
Thank you, doctor.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
हेलो कौन कॉल कौन किया बोलो मतलब कॉल कौन कॉल कौन की है, बोलेगा कौन?
Okay.